Hey guys, welcome back to Maury's Music and another episode of Virtual Tour. But not really, this is kind of a weird one. We're going to have a real interesting show for you this afternoon. A lot of times we'll show you some Blueridge guitars, some Martin guitars. It'll just be me. That whole formula, it's not going to happen today. We got all Blueridge all the time. We have one whole hour full of really cool instruments from Saga Music. And two very cool people from Saga Music, David and Isaac, are going to join us. We're going to try to juggle perfectly on equal parts playing guitar, talking guitar, and Q&A. So if you have a question that only the people at Saga Music can answer, today's your lucky day. If you wanted to see an M36, today's not your lucky day. There's no Martins. There's no Martin people here. No Martin questions. Of course, if you have a Martin question, I'll do my best to answer it. But today's our unique opportunity to dive deep into the Blueridge pre-war line. We have some really cool instruments that probably no other dealer has. So we're going to take a look at things like the 240, the 280, the 263, the 283, maybe even a BR-73 CE. Point being, today's all about Blueridge. We got some Blueridge people here to help me. If I play my cards right, I don't have to talk or play guitar nearly as much as normal, and that could be good for everybody. So sit back, enjoy a virtual tour of our current Blueridge inventory, Blueridge Takeover. It starts right now. All right, guys, we're ready. I hope you guys are ready for some fastballs. I got some really cool people in the chat, and I know people like David and Isaac are just ready to put all the good hard knowledge on us. I want to introduce for the first time on the virtual tour program, David and Isaac from Saga Music. David, why don't you go first and tell us exactly what you do at Blueridge Guitars?
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is David Gartland, and I'm the marketing director with Saga. And I want to thank all of you for coming, and thank you, Maury, for inviting me to be here. It's an honor. Thank you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Who's this other guy with you?
Well, I'd like to say I could speak for him, but I'll just say his name and let him go from there. He's an old friend of mine and a colleague of world renown, Isaac Moore. We'll let him go take it from there.
I know he's soft spoken
for him,
but yeah,
he's soft spoken.
Isaac,
your sound,
I'm not sure.
Is very soft spoken.
Can you hear us? We can't hear you anymore. Maybe that's good. Maybe that's bad.
Uh-oh.
Do you have? Are you? Maybe you're muted.
Well, there you.
Huh.
How's that for technology?
Like I was saying, David, tell us more about yourself.
Well, sure. It's kind of fun because we really wanted this to be sort of a normal, real thing. So any of y'all out there who are joining this, feel free to feel like you're at home with us. So what I do at Saga is, being the marketing director, I wear a lot of hats. And, one of them is thinking about Blueridge guitars all the time, how to make them better, how to think of new things to do, and how to remain true to what we really wanted to do with the guitar, but all of our product categories, all of our product lines, but we won't get into that too much. But you know, what I try to do is make sure that what we're doing is it meets the expectations of all those great guitar players out there, who are really trying to get the most value for their dollar. And so I try to make sure that what we do on inside, make the guitars right, present the message properly, and make sure everybody really can tell that same story so that they really know what they're getting. Our guitars are more than just an object. There's a story behind all of them. And it goes back to those other brands you mentioned. We pay a lot of homage to that. So that's what I do. I try to make the message be clear and exciting and keep raising the bar.
Nice. Well, I'll take this opportunity to slide a little bit of a hint towards Isaac. My side of the program does say that you muted yourself in Ecamm. Maybe it's not an iPhone button, but maybe when I asked you at the beginning of the program, Be careful to mute yourself during the beginning part of the show. Maybe there's an Ecamm button you need to push to unmute. Or, like you warned me about, for weeks and weeks and weeks, I might be stuck talking to David for a straight hour. And even if you weren't muted, there was an opportunity you weren't going to get to talk anyway. So I'm going to take this opportunity to see if Isaac can get himself connected there. And before I get too far into this first guitar, David, can you speak to the point? I wanted to show my viewers here some of the new arrivals here at Maury's Music were really exciting to me because they're part of the pre-war series, and I don't want to get top to bottom, big thing for me. But in general, can you please help the audience understand what these pre-war guitars are and why, when you buy a guitar from Blue Ridge, it starts with the number 2? Why is that different?
Ah, that's a great question, and I think it's kind of one that all the Blue Ridge fans out there probably know better than me. But I'll tell you what we tried to do was we tried to be memorable and have everything have a meaning. So when you like a Martin, when you buy one, you know what the numbers mean, and you're able to get the guitar you want. So when it came to the pre-war, we actually have 3 series of guitars. It's a contemporary series, the historic series, and the pre-war series. And the pre-war series is indeed that. It's guitar designs that are harkening back to instruments made before World War II, 1939, let's say. And for those of you who know the guitars that we are paying homage to, you'll know that there are things done differently back then. Material availability, specifications were different pre-war style guitars versus guitars from the, let's say, the 50s, 60s, and 70s by all makers, really. There's big neck old guitars and things like that. So, for example, on a pre-war, when a 2 in the front of that number, any 3-digit number is going to mean it's an all-solid guitar. But a 2 will tell everyone that it's a pre-war guitar, series guitar. And so the second digit, a 4, a 6, or an 8, basically just tells you what the back and side material wood is. So from 3 digits, you know that it's all solid, you know that it's pre-war, and you may know that it's either, for example, in your hand, a 240, 4 equals mahogany, 6 would equal rosewood, Indian rosewood nowadays. We can talk about that. And then on the pre-war end, the 6 or the 8 would mean Santos rosewood, which is a Brazilian rosewood sort of substitute that a lot of the makers are using because Brazilian is illegal in many senses to use. So it's an alternative that has the look, sound, and a lot of characteristics of Brazilian. So it's kind of, and that, if you go back pre-war, that's when they were using Adirondacks on guitars. So that would [S2] Sure. [S1] Be a pre-war guitar. Let's say 50s would have Sitka spruce, more commonly done, because the war effort limited the availability of resources, wood materials. So pre-war we're Adirondack, and that's what our pre-war series has. Which incidentally, I should tell all the viewers that back in 2007 or so, when we were the first company right around there to offer Adirondack spruce tops on a production-made guitar. Not even Martin was doing that. And what you would have to do is pay for the upgrade, and it would be a costly endeavor. Worth the money, of course, it'd be great sound. But we were the first company to bring Adirondack to the mass market in a production guitar. And that's really, right around 2007 or so, that's when we really started to light the fuse on what was to become what they are today.
Nice, that's really interesting. I'm going to take an opportunity now, before we forget to play guitar at all during this hour, I'm going to play a little bit of the BR-240, and I'm going to have to tell Isaac, I'm still watching your page back here. It still does say that the guest has muted himself. I do think in Ecamm you have muted, so I'm going to, hold out hope that we can talk to you. You really have to hear his voice. It is a beautiful thing. He does have a speaking voice. I heard it before earlier today. And let's just give him a couple minutes to get things started, but that gives me more time to play some guitar. So let's check out the BR-240 from the pre-war series. I like your hair, Isaac. Thank you.
Maury, I noticed an interesting question when you were playing that about the bracing on the pre-war guitars I saw on the side there. Can I hit that? I should have mentioned that.
Well, you can, but let's see if Isaac can help us hit that too. I think he might be finally coming through.
Oh, okay. Quiz time.
I'm often wrong about Isaac and his audio, so let's see. Let me introduce you guys to Isaac. Can we hear you this time?
Can you hear me?
All right.
Yes.
I believe we can.
I don't know what happened.
I don't want to put you on the spot or make you feel uncomfortable. I keep telling you that Walmart, what is it called? Not Sprint, T-Mobile, but that cheap calling plan. It doesn't work
prepaid.
For iPhones.
It doesn't work.
You can't dial into a Maury's Music live stream with a prepaid phone card anymore. Stop doing that.
Yeah, I don't know what happened. As soon as we started the live stream, everything just didn't work anymore.
That's called live streaming, and I'm sure our guests in the chat who we're going to say hello to really quickly would already recognize that happens all the time. I thought it was going to happen to David and not you, but tell us a little bit about yourself, Isaac.
So my name is Isaac Moore. I am a Saga Music sales representative. I am Maury's sales representative, and I've also been a Saga artist for the past 10 to 11 years now.
Wow. Was it 10 or 11? I guess it's not that that monumental to you if you forget which one it is, right?
I'm 20, so I can't remember that far back.
Wow. You went right to it. I thought, you know, we're going to ease into like how much older we are than you, but you went right to 20. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, maybe it wasn't a good thing to get you on microphone, but let's get back to David's point. David saw a really good question. Why don't you hit that, David? It's a good time to stop Isaac from saying things like 20 years old.
Yeah. Well, he'll astound you with more things later. We'll leave that for that time. But for now, I think, your viewers are excellent. They're very astute. And as they would have assumed, pre-war, we weren't messing around. Pre-war meant wide nut. 1 3/4, and it also means forward shifted scalloped bracing, like the old school stuff. And that actually, I should say, is on all Blueridge guitars. Imagine that. So we took, that's the other thing, we took those most notable features that make those really old guitars be unbelievably sounding and most coveted by collectors, and tried to apply them at even a BR40, for example, which you're aware of, and those of you out there are aware of. So even at the affordable price point, we try to infuse those features that make the guitar sound right. And so they are forward shifted X bracing, and again, pre-war would have the wider nut than the historic series, but we can get there eventually. But since it's pre-war time, they all have those characteristics.
Nice. Well, I'm a little bit off my game here because we started upside down a little bit with the audio. Shame on me for not saying hello to our guests. Let me just make sure we get caught up. We have David Belcher here, and you two guys from Saga wouldn't know unless I told you he is almost always the first person here. When he's not first, we think something's wrong and he's hurt. So good to see you, David.
Oh, my God.
Jim Bailey, Mark Henry. Mark Johnson is here from Bristol, Virginia. We sometimes get weather reports. Mark Henry, Thomas Wingrath. Liliana, what? Liliana from San Francisco? That sounds really familiar. Let us know in the chat if you know who that is. That's what we call a ringer. She's a little connected to Saga Music in some ways. And all I'll say is when I was in Nashville having a great dinner with Isaac, Liliana was at the same table. So we'll say it that way. Our good friend Steve Smith
is
here.
Yeah, I got the bill, though.
You did.
I got the bill.
That's how it should happen.
Worth it. It was worth
It was worth it to me that you got the bill, too. BMO is here. What's up, BMO?
Of course.
Charles loves the Adirondack Tops, and Liliana says, love Isaac, talent, young artist. Let's hear him play. Wow, that's exactly how we scripted that, Liliana. Thank you very much for saying so. And I want to take this opportunity, first of all, to thank Isaac and David for being here and to remind everybody in the chat, today's program might go a little heavy on questions and a little bit light on playing. And it all depends on what you guys want out of this program. So as your questions come in, I'm going to try to play a couple guitars for you, but it's probably more important for me to let this opportunity happen where if you have questions only Saga can answer, today's the day to get that done. If we get near the 1 hour mark and there's still something you haven't seen that's behind me, I could just put it on YouTube in its own video. So please let us know. I think somebody mentioned some excitement about a BR-163, something like that. Isn't on today's docket, per se, but if we have time, we'll do anything we can. So I've been looking at the chat with one eye, now that we have all the audio working. Can I ask Isaac or David, did you see any good question that I might have missed that should actually be addressed right now?
Can I shout out to Bristol, Virginia, by the way? Or
absolutely,
Bristol, Tennessee, depending upon what side of the road you want to stand on. I love both sides, but we love Bristol. It's a great town, man. It's like the music flows from the water that's flowing from the hills there. It's a wonderful place. And if you all don't know, we named a guitar line after Bristol. It was such a great thing. And if you see Bristol guitars, those are by Blueridge. So anyway, had to plug that.
Nice. Well, same here. You see anything from your favorite hometown there, Isaac?
I have been trying to keep up with the comments and everything, but I haven't been able to keep up very well just yet.
Well,
so if anything catches my eye, I will make sure it's known.
That's going to happen. And you guys watching from home, please let us know. If you typed something 20 minutes ago and it just got completely buried, type it again. We don't mind seeing it twice. If there's a good important question, we don't want to skip it. I was starting to play the BR-240, and I'm happy to say a lot of people in chat, they know that I'm a Rosewood guy. This is the last mahogany guitar I have next to me on the stand. I'm full of Rosewood now with things like a BR-260, BR-283. I think I even have a BR-263. And I'm probably going to get in a lot of trouble, but David, do you have a preference, Rosewood or mahogany?
Actually, I love all guitars, and my wife would tell you that by the closet that's full of all different kinds. But honestly, I love them all, of course, but I'm actually a simple kind of guy. I'm a mahogany kind of guy. I love D18 styles, and our 140 is like, I love our 140. It's like the best, I think personally, it's one of the best bangs for the buck. If you play not just bluegrass or whatever, you can play any style of music with a BR-140, and you feel like you've made a good investment. Like, you don't have to have a number of guitars, but like I said, I love them all, and it depends on my mood. I might play a Rosewood or a mahogany. It's just all part of the, that's what makes it so fun, you know. That's what makes all this such a joy, is that they're all great. Just depends where you, what you feel like, you know. But I understand you saying Rosewood. I can understand that. And there's a lot of cats down there in Bristol that like Rosewood, man. The bones, you know, the booming bottom end and the bright, you know, the articulate stuff. You know, I agree. So hard to choose, though. Yeah. I could see why.
And it's funny. I had a customer on the phone a couple days ago, and we were talking about the BR-140 for a while, and then the BR-240. And it's not polite for me to like repeat conversations, but the gist of it was, are you sure the BR-140 is priced right? And I would say, yeah. And he's like, but what's wrong with it? And he couldn't believe that what he was going to get in the Blue Ridge line, to get a solid Sitka spruce top and, you know, the scallop bracing and the things that you get in a BR-140. He wasn't really an Adirondack fan, and that was why we didn't really talk about the 240 as much. But the fact that we kind of discussed what his playing style was like, why we both thought, as best I could, you know, in a short conversation, why Sitka might be nicer for him the way he was describing what he likes. He was so puzzled that he might like the one that's less expensive. And are you sure you didn't forget, like, to put a zero at the end of that? And it was kind of cute because he's like, I'm going to have to do some more research. No hard feelings, but that can't be right. And he's actually so afraid of the value there that he wants to look for more YouTube videos. And the good news is all the videos he's going to find, most of them are going to come from me. I'm proud of the way the 140 sounds also. And the fact that I'm here bragging about the 240s and the 200s, make no mistake, when you look at the 160, the 140, those guitars, just those two, not even talking about the OMs, they are so big sounding for more than the money, that when someone comes to my website and wants to talk about, I think I want a two something, but what should I do? And they recognize that the Sitka might be better for them. It's a nice conversation to have when people recognize they don't have to buy the most expensive thing we're talking about. And that, ironically, it seems to come down to, I mean, Laurie and I were talking the other night, the 140 just seems to be something of a sweet spot for Blue Ridge, and I'm sure that's by design, you know.
Well, you know, obviously, you know, mahogany's not as expensive per se to use, and that's what helps keep price points down, but they were never highly ornamented style guitars, so it's you don't need a lot of ornamentation for it to sound great, you know. And I think what it comes down to is we all have a limited number of bucks in our wallet, and so why would you? I understand the gentleman was having a tough time, but you know, he needs to pinch himself and say, look, it's okay, I'm gonna leap, because he will find that it has been proven that way. It's a Swiss Army knife of a guitar. I think, though, you know, there is a reason why you'd want the 240. You know, you want a wider nut, 1 3/4 inch versus 1 11/16. You want, you prefer old school stylings like the, you know, like, for example, the Adirondack. Another of your viewers mentioned that it takes a while to break in the Adirondack. I was reading the comment, and it is true. But what it does happen when it does break loose, you know what happens, Maury, it just becomes a cannon, it like a piano that's wide open. And that is only limited by the amount of time the person devotes to breaking that baby loose. And so to answer that question by saying the options are available depend upon what your budget is, tonally what you want, historically what you want. There's something everywhere, but the value is everywhere.
Right. And that's a good point. Like, you don't have to wish for a 240, but settle for a 140. There's value in every tier. And we're not even talking yet about things like a BR-43. A good friend of mine plays in a local band, and he's had a BR-43 for over 10 years and has never come to say, I want to trade up to get something better, because he loves it to death. He can't stop telling people how good it is. And, you know, it's not for you and I to talk to each other about how great this brand is, but you do need to know feedback that I'm getting. Maybe in the wrong way, a music store owner should sell somebody a BR-43. They're going to come back and get a BR-160. No, they're not necessarily going to. They might just say, hey, joke's on you, I'm going to keep this BR-43 forever. And I've seen him play at gigs, a buddy of mine named Danny, and I've actually sat in with him and played his guitar that started out here, and I put a pickup in for him, and I've played that specific thing. And, you know, yeah, this stuff's really good. Today's program is not about the BR-43, but if you're looking at the Blue Ridge line, watching this live stream, whether it's live or on the replay, don't think you've got to step up to 160 or 260. And you know, Isaac can speak to that same point too. I did see a comment on the bottom of the screen. Jim doesn't see a 12-string guitar on the Saga website. Are there plans on having a 12-string? Can I point that one towards Isaac? Because he's I saw sales.
Sure, I'd like
his
to.
Name a few minutes
I'd
ago.
Like to let him go for it. Yeah.
That's just want to see if your mic's still working.
Is my mic still working? Can you hear me? Is this thing on? Is there going to be a 12-string? As of right now, we do not have a 12-string, but it may be something to push towards if, you know, enough dealers are interested in them, or if enough end users are interested. Kind of, you know, pry at us a bit, and it may be something that we can twist some arms on.
So hold on.
Let me add to that. Let me add to that a little. In that we did make them. We made them a number of them. And in fact, it was probably maybe 2 or 3 years ago we discontinued our 12-string. It was more like a body shaped like a jumbo. Let's just say in the vein of that. It was a big body guitar like a piano. I think there's an artist out there. If y'all look, his name's Brian McKenzie. He plays that you know, a jumbo version of our guitar, and you'll see the shape. But guys like, for example, here you go, Chris Hillman, you know that name.
Oh wow!
He has a Blue Ridge 12-string that he plays when he plays around with Herb Peterson, who has a BR-160A. And I don't, for those of you know, Chris Hillman, let's say the Birds, folks. Herb Peterson, well. Desert Rose Band, like we go on and on, John Denver. You know, these are guys who play those guitars, and they played them, but they did, at least the 12-string didn't get the attention, I think, in the market that we would have hoped for. Y'all know it's a specific tool, right? So I think Isaac's right that let's all band together and demand another 12-string. And we'll make phone calls to Saga, info@sagamusic.com, write emails. Send Maury, call his cell phone number directly. Lori likes it when you call her directly, yeah. And just say, hey, we want 12 strings. And maybe Isaac can talk Maury into maybe doing a special Maury version. I don't know. But I'll tell you, they were great guitars. And when you capoed them up on maybe five, 4 or 5 frets up there, maybe A, B, pianos. pianos these guitars sounded like. So if you want a 12-string, used market is what I was going to get to. You'll find them rare because people who got them like them, but you'll find them. So take a look.
Yeah, I thought it was kind of funny how Isaac, without, you know, wasting any time, let's see if the dealers can put some interest together. And, of course, the end user has to show dealer interest. The dealer's got to show Saga interest. But I do think it's a little funny that Isaac went at me before he went at the end user, and I'm going to remember that.
Well, that's what we pay him for, and that's good. So he's at your throat right now, so I'm sure you'll be ordering several soon enough. No, but I think that the point is that that chain has to happen, you know, where... Yeah. The customer and consumer really needs to understand why there's a limit in the market, because not a lot of people buy 12 strings. Sadly, it's unfortunate. It's like left-handed guitars. People are left out who are left-handed because they don't make many, but it's sad. But it's how, unfortunately, you have to do things. Sadly, it's just production efficiencies. And if we can make a 12-string efficient, we'll do it. So don't lose hope, but... Please mention it to anybody you think will listen, and we will hear it, and we will keep pleading the case. I promise. I want to make every kind of guitar ever. I know Isaac does, but, you know.
Well, in the spirit of that same thing, Mark brings up a very good question. This might be selfishly my best opportunity to ask Saga where things are going, because the fact that we just brought the Blueridge line back not very long ago, we caught you guys in a period of transition. We're updating some of our old products to show exactly what the new specs are. But as we're doing that, literally, Andrew and I are putting together some things on the website that's changing as we're typing them. Mark wants to know, is the Santos rosewood described as premium rosewood in the guitar descriptions? Maybe, can I paraphrase and assume he means when Maury tells you that a guitar's got premium rosewood, is that Santos? And maybe a better question is, can you help us understand the different rosewoods used in the current Blue Ridge lineup? Whichever one of you guys wants to tackle that one.
I'll start and I'll let Isaac jam in there. Okay, all of you, I'm sure your viewers know that, you know, certainly woods there are certain woods, rosewoods, that have been banned, whether it be through overforestation in the old days, Brazilian is one, and then certainly most recently, in the last, four or five years, there's something called CITES, which was an organization that was devoted to protecting resources, wildlife, animals, wood sources, and really looking out for improper forestation, you know, doing it wrongly and depleting, you know, wood sources around the world. So as a result of that, and it wasn't the musical instrument industry that created this need to do this, but you know, furniture business. There's a lot of industries in the world that use rosewoods. So Indian rosewood was banned. Maybe let's say for the last 4 or 5 years. I'm not getting specific with dates, but you all know when you couldn't see Indian rosewood. So what we had to do was, let me step back. We used Brazilian before, and then the laws were reenacted again in, I think, 2015, where we couldn't, or maybe a little earlier, we couldn't use it anymore. So that's why some early Blue Ridge you'll see Brazilian. And then later, East Indian rosewood was banned by another agreement, the CITES agreement. And so now two kinds of rosewood were banned, Brazilian and Indian rosewood. So what do you do when your premium rosewood, which we would say would be Santos rosewood, premium meaning level of guitar, you can get premium Indian rosewood. And our Indian rosewood is quite choice or select or however you want to call it. But when we say premium, we're talking about perhaps the level associated with a pre-war higher level guitar, so Brazilian. And Santos rosewood would probably be what we would say premium. Indian rosewood would probably be, as we're moving forward, now that we can use it this year, might be more considered select or, you know, it's really a fine line of delineation of words. But when we say premium, it's likely going to be the Santos rosewood, which is our Brazilian equivalent, and which would be a pre-war idea, versus Indian rosewood, which would be a historic series or a post-war material with Sitka. Sitka, you know, commonly, more commonly after the war. So we just kind of blended the specifications that made sense. So yes, premium is Brazilian-esque or Santos. Choice would be Indian. Let's see, we just started doing Indian again just this year. And so, because we could. And so we're going to, you know, you're going to see that evolve into its own terminologies and stuff. But let's just say 200 series uses all more higher grade woods. And then a 100 series uses high grade woods, but maybe not as high a grade as the pre-war. And that's what delineates that price point difference. Adirondack's more expensive too than Sitka. Santos more than Indian. So premium is the high, better materials, let's say, in terms of visual appearance. Tonally, I would say that, well, certainly Santos and Indian sound a little different, but it's just a different sound, not a better or worse. They both are great. So I hope that helped a little.
It does, yeah. And I'm going to put Isaac to the test. I have a BR-260 in my lap. Can you tell our viewers what rosewood is on this guitar?
That would be, I believe these are Indian, because these are the new 200.
No, he said he had a 200.
The 200?
260.
260, so that would be Santos. Okay, yeah. I heard that wrong.
Look at that. Look at
Speaking
that grain
of that
on
wrong,
there.
Would you like to hear it?
Absolutely. See, I haven't gotten to see one of these or hear one of these in person yet, because pretty much all of them are at Maury's.
Yeah, that's true. None of us really did. So Maury, you're the man.
That question confused me a little bit.
Well, if I can confuse somebody, I'll try every time. BR-260.
Ooh, you... your electric on that, Isaac, to play that riff. Even I heard the differences in those two guitars, given the technology we're using. I could hear where that's rosewood, that the guttural depth, the bottom end on there, you know that's rosewood every time. You really do.
It's like that big E, you know.
Love it.
So, like, Isaac, yeah. I guess if you want to play this, you have to come to Maury's Music. Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah, you know, I would love to. Whenever I'm allowed to come by, you just let me know.
Well, we are taking the temperature of the world every day, and as soon as it becomes safe enough, you two are going to be two of the first people to be here, and we're going to have this kind of show, except I'll be able to reach over. And make sure both microphones are working without going through iPhones and Zoom. But we look forward to that opportunity as early as we can. And Charles says, don't discount the Blueridge laminates. He has a BG-40 that sounds better than most Gibsons. If I remember correctly, in our pre-production meetings, all three of them, one of you guys has some BG guitar nearby or actually on camera. Can I put you to task there?
Well, I agree with that young man, because I thought I'd want to bring something that maybe people hadn't seen before. This is actually the prototype of the BG series. The first, very, 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 very first one. Very first one. It's a BG-160. It's a little scuffed up a little bit, but it was designed, this is where we were going. We wanted to do this. Now, I think a lot of your viewers, they understand what this guitar is, even the laminates. It's got a really special tone. The thing that is interesting, I think I'm going to just say this out there, but I'll answer it myself, even though I'm going to wait to see if anybody else answers it. do they really know what guitar we were kind of paying homage to? What guitar are we paying homage to in the BG series? Now, I'll let that sit for a second while we chat a bit and see if anybody can answer that correctly, because it might sound like a trick question. But what we, the reason I brought this is because we changed the line around a little bit, so we focused it down to certain models, and the BGs are going to, we took a little time off right now. We're going to relook at that line, so there's not a whole lot being made right now, and that comes down to production too. I think it's one of those things where people don't know what they've got until it's gone, and we, right now, we kind of put it on a hiatus, though I think there's a special order of a certain number of the BGs coming in. Special, maybe you have some on order, Maury. I'm not sure. Isaac, you would know. You guys would know that better. But any, I'm going to see if anybody answered that while I'm segueing. Does anybody know what? No. Well, I'm going to help you all out because I don't know if I see the answer there. Does anybody know? I bet you all think it was Gibson. Well, kinda. Gibson made guitars for National in the 1950s. Take a look at that sunburst. That looks like no Gibson sunburst, does it? And the body shape, look at these square shoulders. A little bit square, not quite so slopey. So this is basically, there's a story to this guitar that my boss, Richard Keltson, owns an original one, and he got it in a box of other stuff, and it was in pieces forever. And finally he had it put together. And I believe at the time in San Francisco, Tony Rice was in and out of his store. Tony was in San Francisco back in those days. We're talking late 70s, when we were really the hub for bluegrass, and Tony Rice would teach guitar at a Richard shop from time to time, believe it or not, folks. But he would come into the shop with Grissman, all those cats. But one day he saw Richard with this guitar built, and he just had to have that guitar. But Richard never gave it to Tony Rice, and thank God he didn't, because we were able to use the guitar to make this. So all the BG40s and 60s have the same DNA, just maybe a laminate back and side, solid top versus an all-solid model, which is what this one is. But I thought y'all'd like to see that we really care about making these guitars. Even the old ones, you know, everything we do has that story. If the guitar didn't sound good, or we didn't feel like it was going to be something that, if it didn't move us tonally, we probably aren't going to do it. And in this case, who else would have ever thought to make this guitar? Yeah. unless you tried and heard one, and it mind-boggling. A little shorter scale than a BR. Like it's a Gibson kind of scale, so it's a lot of fun to play. So I'm really proud that your viewers really understand the BG line and where it is, and I think that will be ready. They'll probably come back.
Nice. Yeah. That's good information.
To some extent.
If anybody in the chat wants to let us know if you do have an older Gibson or an older BG from Blue Ridge. I'd love to know which guitar you're playing, or even if you had it, did you keep it? Did you let it go? Speaking of that, I know that David's not the only person on this stream that brought some good guitars from his own arsenal. Isaac, what are you playing these days, and what do you have with you?
So the guitar that I use the most, and in fact, I just played a four-hour set at the Floor of Emma yesterday with, is my BR260A from like 2014, I believe.
Awesome.
Got an LR Bags pickup in it, which is what we are using now. And
does that have that back on it? Flip that around real quick.
The back stripe. Let's see if I can get it without the reflection.
Ooh, the sapwood.
Damn.
Wow.
Look at that, man.
Wow.
Ooh. Yeah, it's a beauty. That was a big selling point for me, other than the sound and just the quality itself.
Wow, that's awesome.
I just had to have it.
And I know we're not set up with real expensive microphones on your end, but can you play like maybe 10 seconds on that so we could just see what your fingers do?
Yeah, just sure. Let's see what I can come up with. Let's see. Let's see. Uh,
Most That's applause really he
Thank
got
you.
in 2 days.
Oh.
Thanks, David.
No, I won't touch that one. That's, you know. You fight nice, guys. That's not for me to jump in there and say anything about. But
I do have to say one thing, though. Isaac has one problem in that when he comes to work with us at the trade shows, he's such a music lover and a guitar lover. His problem is that if he touches one of our Blue Ridge, like I'd say 80% of the time he's had to have it. He's had to buy it. I promise you, everyone in his not everyone in his collection is that way, but he's got probably more than I even know anymore. But he's moved by the wall of guitars. But I think that's normal. I think that happens to anyone. Any of your fans over there who are viewing this would do the same thing if they had that access. So it's just funny with Isaac. He knows what tone is, and if he hears it, you're moved, right? You can't be denied. So. I appreciate that with him in that, yeah.
You heard it here first. The inconvenient truth is if it's a really, really great Blue Ridge, you'll never see it because it won't ever leave the sales staff.
You know, I think that's the moral of the story. That's why that stripe on that guitar he's got there, I think maybe a parlor or something. Any number of guitars that happen that way, and it's like I have to say no. But then I have to say yes because he can't help himself.
Yeah,
you know, can I answer a question one more on that line? Liliana's asking one, and I'll hear it from her at the office if I don't answer it now. So let's just give her this one. She wants to know which guitars Blue Ridge's Paul McCartney has and plays. And he has actually has three of our guitars. One, the most recent one that he has is a 240A or a 240. And you'll see photographs where he's sitting in Abbey Roads behind a piano, maybe an upward shot looking down, and there's a guitar in the background. That's the 240A. And then there's another one that he's got. And this is kind of fun. He got two guitars at this time in England through our distribution there. One of them is a 160, you know, another Swiss Army knife of a guitar. It does it all, and it's not too expensive. A left-handed, of course, and then the other guitar he got was a left-handed D500, one of our Gitan Gypsy Jazz guitars, a left-handed version, which is very rare. Maybe the only other guy I know of that got one of those is Elliot Easton from the Cars. He has a left-handed one. But so, you know, it's kind of funny that, you know, and I don't mean to be pulling stories like that, but the story it happens naturally when we talk about our guitars where. They just sort of end up in places that I would never have thought. You know, people recognize things that maybe they own a bunch of old Martins, Maury. I've heard that 1,000 times, you know, just up the road from Bristol, up there in southwestern Virginia. I've heard that 1,000 times. I got four Martins. They're under the bed. I protect them, and I take my Blue Ridge to the picking circle, and I say, you're crazy. Play those Martins too, please, because I don't want anything to happen to those. But play that Blue Ridge because it'll powerhouse in across all the mix of everybody at the coffee house picket circle you're at over on the weekend or on a Tuesday night. And that's really 9 times out of 10. If I've heard it once, I've heard it 1,000 times that people have used us to protect their other love. But what that tells me is they secretly love this new love. And that's, I mean, that's a reward that we couldn't have asked for because we're just trying to make an honest guitar.
No, I agree. And there's a way to be, you know, creative and not take your best one out all the time. And then at some point, the guitar you're replacing it with isn't good enough and you won't stay doing it. So if somebody's buying a Blue Ridge so they can protect their old vintage Martin and it does last, that does speak to what the Blue Ridge is doing for sure, you know?
Sure. And everybody, you know, many people, even in your viewers here, they have any number of guitars, many brands, and it's all good. Even the artists we work with have various brands they play. And you know what? Honestly, that doesn't bother me because they know when to use them. And 9 times out of 10, they play our guitar. I mean, we've seen it. So that's the thing. It's just an everyman guitar that everybody could feel like they could be in a simple club and not sacrifice any sort of sound. Any tone or dollars, money, you know, let's face it.
Well said. And speaking of, you threw it back to Isaac a few moments ago. We talked about special ordering something like a 12-string. I'm going to throw probably the toughest question you guys might see this afternoon. I'm going to throw it at Isaac. Isaac, if you want to make some kind of signal that deflects that question and pushes it over to David, that's up to you. Are you guys ever going to do any nitro finishing?
David.
That's a tricky question, actually, because we'd love to do it, actually. But what it really comes down to, there's a couple of things. There's a lot of areas involved. It would be a price issue. We would have to address certain things that maybe the process is more complex and it changes everything, the dynamic on the end to the consumer. And I'm not sure if you do the finish like we do correctly, that you're gaining that much more by doing a nitro. We've engineered our finish to be super thin and a polyester coat that's designed to protect. And that's really the point, protect and still breathe, you know, but have luster. You know, if they had polyurethane back in those days when they were trying to smash the Beatles to make lacquer and make nitro and blow themselves up, I imagine they would have just used it. They just didn't invent it back then. It wasn't done. So I think there's a lot of things. I mean, certainly there's a thickness, there's a density of finish on an instrument that can, arguably people can say, affects vibrations. I could show examples where, yes, it can affect it, but not necessarily derogatorily. I could give you examples where, well, Carter Stanley guitar with a giant pickguard on the face. Sounds great. People love it. You know, it has that sound. So can we make nitro? I think right now at our factory, we're not really probably set up to do it just yet for a number of reasons. But I think in the future, we will look at it. The thing I would mention to you all, though, is that there's probably very few fully nitro guitars made in China, like fully nitro finished. There are combo finishes where maybe nitro and then finished with other materials. So you want to really understand what you're buying. And I think the key really is just play the guitar. And then if it sounds good, it is. And if it doesn't sound good, and who cares what the finish is? I mean, I say that sort of jokingly, but... Yeah. There's a lot of things that we could do, and we don't want to take ourselves out of the realm of affordability for people if the sacrifice in changing that spec isn't going to add that much more. Because we could have two Blue Ridges together, nitro and poly, and just depending on who made it that day, the poly might sound better. You know, who knows? It's construction. There's a lot of variables that go into sound, as you know, Maury, and you know. Yeah. The convoluted answer it be, but right now we're not gonna planning it. But we would when the time comes, if we can, we would apply that and do it. We'd make mandolins that way. We do other things, but right now it's not in the cards per se.
Okay, and along the same lines, there, neither one of you guys can grab this question. Torrefaction has become really popular in the last several years, and a lot of the Martins, you know, come with a torrefied top and/or bracing. Charles asks if you guys are looking at doing any cooktops in the future.
You know that answer, Isaac? I can think of one right now that we do, but we don't really sell it ourselves. And this is for all you real bluegrass fans. You all know who Ralph Stanley was. Well, his son, Ralph Stanley II, we make a signature guitar for him called a BR6060 Clinch Mountain Special. And what we did for that guitar was totally redesigned it all the way up from bottom to top, and that has a torrefied top. And that's the only one we do. And it's just for what he was wanting to get in terms of an old sound and a look and a feel. Will we do it more? That's interesting. Honestly, I'm not 100% sure, you know, which wins. Because a good piece of Adirondack sounds amazing when it's broken in, right? And you didn't have to treat it to get there. It takes longer. But then a torrefied top can sound really good now and probably break in and sound good too. But then you go to Sitka, which sounds great all the time, like it is already broken in. So, you know, it's a conundrum, but I think right now our Sitka and our Adirondack seem to be the most focused. But with Ralph Stanley, He sells those guitars himself. He's the only place you can get it. And for now, it looks like, you know, who knows, maybe Isaac and Maury will have a nice conversation down the road that might mean that we do something special for Maury. But I think, again, if your fans are see that as something interesting, I'd love to hear them chime in to you and to us and just let us know, because that really will help us plead the case.
Cool. Well, thank you. I'm gonna play a little bit on this BR-283. And while I do that, I want you guys to take a look at the most recent comment. Jim Bailey is saying something very cool about manufacturing and speaking about where you guys do your thing. Think about a good answer for that while I play this BR-283. Please.
You can hit applause for yourself anytime, Maury. That's cheating.
Well,
I would have pressed it for you. Yeah, I would have done it. I would have done it. Yeah. Hey, I got to say something to Mr. Jim. Jim, about the break-in time for Adirondack. You don't have to wait that long. He was talking about he doesn't want to wait for as long as it takes to break Adirondack loose. And honestly, you'd be surprised. You know, you'll play an Adirondack guitar. If you sit with it for an hour, it'll change. You play it for a couple days straight, it's going to change. But what'll happen is it might go back to sleep a little bit until you play it the next day or the next couple of days. And so you just got to train it, you know, and it will break loose and not as long as you think, sir. But if you don't like that, Sitka spruce, right? It's broken in right now. Sitka spruce sounds great. It's broken in today. It gets better with age, but I think Adirondack might take, again, it's preference, people might say, you know, arguably people might say Adirondack will get you a little bit more articulation on the treble side as it ages too, or maintains that. But yeah, I think even if you like Adirondack, don't worry, play it, it'll break in, it'll sound great.
Can't argue with that. I play a Sitka guitar, and I'm one of those in a unique situation. Everything that comes through this store, I can like it. I can be in a mood for it and not commit to it. And people often ask me, you know, do you like Sitka or Adirondack? And I own a Sitka guitar since the late 90s. I've played 10 Sitka guitars for every Adirondack guitar I've played. The times I've played Adirondack, I've loved it. And then somebody would say, well, if you haven't bought yourself an Adirondack guitar, that must mean you don't like it as much. But I can enjoy a guitar 20 minutes after work, be careful with it, put it away. The next day, be in the mood for something entirely different, and falsely or not, come into work on a Monday or a Tuesday, and I don't have to commit to buying one. They're all here. Now, maybe if I'm being smart, I should finally pick something I really do like for the time that it might sell and be gone. But I kind of like Sitka a little bit more than Adirondack if I'm really being pressed. But don't take that to mean that I don't like Addy, because the times I've had stuff come in, especially custom shop stuff, there's an Adirondack guitar, I think, for everybody, even if you don't know you like Adirondack. Hmm. I'd hate to see the customer that has to decide between the two, because they both really do have qualities. Hmm. You know?
Yeah, no, that's true. And that's where maybe the specifications tend to maybe be the ticket. Like, maybe I have a small hand and I like a little bit smaller nut. Well, that'll have to point you somewhere. That'll point you to the historic series versus a pre-war. But you won't sacrifice the sound. You just get more playability, comfort, you know. So, yeah. And I'm like you. What you have is the largest guitar collection closet in the world, and we all dream of that. So you do have every guitar, so you play what you feel. And that's, I think, the moral of this story is you gotta have one of each. A Sitka and a you have a 140 and a 160, a 260 right there. That's your game right there. A 140 and a 260. You got everything you need.
Well, and a 263.
Oh, but. Yeah. I mean, or no, let's make it a 183 or 283 so that you have all the candy and all the pomp and circumstance to show up at the party looking good.
See? And let me put that on Isaac. Isaac, if you're pressed, talking about, you know, 63 versus 83, if you had to choose with a gun to your head, do you like Rose? Do you like the herringbone or pearl?
Herringbone.
Uh-oh.
Me personally, there's a classiness to it that I have to go for. I like it. I'm
nice.
A fan.
So that must mean you probably saw some, you know, pearly Blueridge guitars at trade shows and you looked at them briefly, maybe had a little bit of a fling with them, but then you went back to the side of the trade show that had the herringbone, huh?
Well, yeah. Don't you have a 371? Didn't you smuggle a 371 out in July?
I do. Yeah. But also you were talking about me always taking stuff from the trade shows. At the last trade show that we were at for the Summer NAMM show, where we finally, you know, I finally got to meet Maury, I left that trade show with a BR-160 and a BR-341.
A 341, see? Ugh.
So I'm building up my arsenal as well.
That way you don't have to feel guilty. You don't feel like you left one out. You just play them all.
Andy says his 283A has gotten better and better in 5 and 6 months. That's a good, first of all, congratulations. That's a great guitar. Can we speak briefly about the 283A and why the 283 no longer has the A on the name?
Okay, that's an easy one, actually. Well, kind of. We used to have a 160A and a 260A. They were really almost quite similar, except for fingerboard was Indian versus ebony, or bridge Indian versus ebony. And yet the price points were, there was close overlap. There's a lot, and it had a wide nut. So basically a 160A was basically a not exactly a pre-war guitar. So what we did was we said, wait a minute, we want to make our price points a little easier for people to reach. So we were able to morph the 160A series with the 200 series to make now just the 200 series, which is pre-war, and pre-war infers Adirondack anyway, so who needs the A? No more. So if all the specs are pre-war, it's Adirondack, because you might know better than me, Maury, but with your Martin history, but as far as I know, there were not, I mean, they used Sitka, but mainly it was Adirondack back at that time, and then Sitka kind of was prevalent more 50s onward for the most part after that.
Yeah, and it sounds like just leaving the A there is redundant now. If you're looking at anything on our website, the 260, the 280, that's implied, and actually on the spec sheet that we do have the Adirondack there. It's going to be a little bit of a learning curve for me because I'm so used to going and telling people that if they have the A in the name, it's Adirondack. Now what I need to say is if it's in the 200s, the top is Adirondack, and don't look for the letter
yes.
A. So it's a little bit of a switch, but it's you know, it keeps us on our toes. And if there's one thing I love about being a music retailer, nothing's ever going to stay the same. You can't come into work next week without checking everything on your website for typos, and especially now with things being sourced. But, you know, for Andy liking his 283A, if somebody buys a 283, you have the same guitar, more or less, than Andy's talking about. And I'm excited. I mean, when Lori and I talked about these pre-wars, and, you know, Isaac joked about it moments ago, a lot of the new 200s are here at Maury's Music. Not that they're not anywhere else, but I think we do have a big selection of them in, you know, compared to some other dealers. And regardless of where you shop for your Blue Ridge guitars, you might have your own local dealer. Make sure you support them. But if you're looking for a guitar you can't find anywhere else, you know, we certainly do have a good selection right now. This is one of those situations where the spring and the summer, we were fighting like crazy. Give us inventory of the shelves. We have nothing on the shelves. And then it was like, oh, yeah? And now we have to actually move into our bigger building sooner than we should because we have too many guitars in boxes on the floors. When you guys finally visit the store, you can't put your arms out like this and turn in a circle without hitting a box with a Blue Ridge or a Martin in it. And we're lucky for that. But if somebody's waiting, you know, to see when something's coming in stock, I actually should go to this page here. We do have a bunch already waiting for you. So if there's something on your radar, and you guys can attest to this, if you're looking for a Blueridge, you already know what you want. We want nothing to do with forcing anybody's hand or pushing you towards a sale. But if you already know and you think, when should I get that? Right now is a great time. It's going to be the holiday season. If you go to mauriesmusic.com/Blueridge Guitars, you'll find everything we're wheeling through here is in stock at the time of this video. Of course, if you're watching this video later, who knows what's still here. But, you know, please reach out to us, support@mauriesmusic.com. If there's anything you want to see in the Blueridge lineup, it's probably safe to say that once these are sold out, I can't be entirely sure when we're going to get our next stock. And same with the Martins. It's that time of year where we have more than we thought we would. So as soon as these go, you would think, well, that's great. They have too many guitars. A lot of new orders are pushed into next year, you know, pretty substantially. So let us know without any pressure. If there's something we already do have here and you know what you want, we'd love to have the opportunity to connect you with it. I don't want to keep you guys too long. If there's anything in the chat that I've missed, I'm going to take one last look to see if there's a good question. Can Isaac or David, can you think of anything we haven't touched on that would be of a very good value for our kind viewers to see before we sign off for the evening?
Whew, man, that's a tough one. What do you think, guys?
That is a tough one.
Being out there playing, and you know, you're out there. You were saying you're at the Florabama line right now doing a songwriter thing, right? What do the cats say to you when you show up with a Blueridge guitar? What's the dynamic for all these folks to know the real world scenario for an artist?
Yeah, they love them. I mean, I've been bringing Blueridge into the Songwriters Festival and the Florabama for the past 7 years, and every now and then, you know, a lot of times I'll have a buddy that like is borrowing a guitar from somebody else and they can't make it, so hey, can I borrow your Blueridge? Yeah, of course, you know, here, play it for the full set, and they'll come away just saying, oh my gosh, I've got to get one of these. This is a great a great guitar. You know, this just happened to me like a week and a half ago. A buddy borrowed a guitar and he loved it. So nice. I think
that's a normal thing. Like when people grab them and play them, it's hard not to admit your guilty pleasure all of a sudden. Like it's hard to not admit that it's a great sounding guitar. You know, yeah. Maury, when you get one in someone's hands, it's almost like a done deal. Like almost like the hook is really set, and it's just now up to them to take that just final leap. And that's what I read from what he said. Great, Isaac. Go on, keep going.
Oh yeah. I mean, I know for a fact that I've influenced at least one person that is a very close friend of mine to buy a Blueridge, and he's planning on buying another one. And I think I may have another one that's really, really looking forward to it. So I'm going to you need to give Maury a call.
I think we even have a picture of the last time that happened. Can you tell me what we're looking at if I put this on the screen?
Yeah, so that's the BR-260A that I've got right by my side right now. That was in Frankfurt, Germany for the Music Messe in 2017, I believe. And that was on stage with all the guys in the company, Richard Keldson, David Gartland. I think Don Moser was probably playing bass.
Wow.
So, yeah, we've got the Tora Bora boys, so we all get together.
Not many companies get their staff out there and lay it all out in front of people at trade shows without any practicing in between.
Honestly, right?
I think it served us really well, actually.
Because
we're like
everybody
else. We're normal.
I've got an issue with this picture. I still don't see a Blueridge in this picture, but you got to tell me what this is.
Oh, where was this? This was in Kansas City, I believe, in 2019. And while I don't have a Blueridge in that picture, it was right off to the side for me to play.
Doesn't Kyle have a 163? 3CE too, the guy who's singing,
yes,
on your wherever that is. That's a guy he met that wanted to get a Blueridge because he heard Isaac's, and the lead singer is over there with a 000 cutaway.
Yeah, and now he's wanting to get one of the BR-371s, I believe, because it's really good for songwriting. It's a small guitar that you can just take anywhere. A lot of the times I'll get some ideas in the van and just be able to take a small parlor out while I'm in the passenger seat and get some lyrics down.
And now remind me, you talked earlier in the beginning of the program after your microphone got turned on. How long have you been playing guitar professionally?
I started playing when I was 7, so 13, almost 14 years now.
Well, I don't know
When
if
did
this is
Ralph
okay with
Stanley
you to
make you a
see.
Kentucky Colonel?
What was that?
Or, I mean, when did Ralph Stanley make you a Clinch Mountain Boy? And then when did you become a Kentucky Colonel?
I was 7 when I was made an honorary Clinch Mountain Boy, and that was at the Myrtle Beach Thanksgiving festival, and I believe it was that very festival that kind of influenced the guitar playing. You know, I hadn't been playing guitar yet, so.
That's what's crazy, Maury, is he's up there singing and flopping around at 7, and they're like, okay, you're in the band. And then like a month later, he's playing like Django Reinhardt. I mean, it's you want to punch him.
I do. I'd like to. I'm not sure which way to. Is this the right way?
Yeah, there you got him.
All
That's it. That's it.
right.
That's
But
it.
the I
Oh.
and I worked hard to find in this next picture because I mean I've only known Isaac a very short time, but we finally even managed to find a picture of the last time Isaac was shorter than Maury. He was already on stage for years and years. This is from one of the NAMM shows, I believe. Is this something? Where's my picture here? Is this right?
Yes, that's the
That's
Tora Bora
hilarious.
voice. That's
I was going to
it.
make that joke much earlier, but I'm still not really sure if you were shorter than me in this picture. That's why I didn't say it earlier. So,
That's hilarious.
what year is that?
Oh man.
Oh
God,
gosh,
good
that had to
question.
be like 2011.
Wow.
Yeah. And see that guitar Richard has, the Blue Ridge over there? That's this one right here. That's exactly this guitar. The Brazilian Rosewood Carter Stanley. You see that
Oh,
back inside,
really?
everybody over there in the chat room? That ought to hurt.
Wow.
Whoops, let me get it. That ought to hurt, huh?
Wow.
What do you think of that? Angel wings.
Look at that. That's that
And
guitar.
see if you, this is that exact same guitar. And I think there's maybe three or maybe three or four at most of these. The other one Ralph Stanley has or had passed away, of course, but he gave it to his grandchild, Ralph Stanley did, and so that'll stay in the Stanley family forever, the other Brazilian Carter Stanley guitar. But you know, I brought that only because up because a lot of people ask about that. So anyway, 2003, 2004, you might find a Brazilian Rosewood Blue Ridge. Find them used.
Wow, that's awesome. I can't believe that's sitting next to you for an hour and I didn't talk about it until now.
Why not do Adirondack as torrified? Sorry, I just read that question.
Wow.
Because it would be you wouldn't need to. You know, torrification is trying to make a top sound like an Adirondack top that's old, I think. I mean, theoretically, let's say they're trying to crystallize the things in there. So I would say if you got an Adirondack top that's good, let her be. Let her be. If you've got maybe another really good piece of spruce and you want to get a little bit more out of it, you might torrify it, you know, Carpathian, you know, all kinds of spruces. But that's my opinion. But you talk to many and they might have different opinions, you know.
Sure. Well, that's a fair question, Andy. And for everybody who likes the Adirondack the way it is, you know, a lot of manufacturers are having a lot of success doing, you know, torrified tops, and it's not
I don't hear
a
you,
side of the
Maury.
argument you can. No?
I'm not hearing you, Maury.
Am I muted? Oh, I didn't mean to be.
Oh, I don't
Oh.
hear him. You hear him? Okay.
Uh-oh. I
I
was saying it's
have a technical difficulty here.
we almost made it to the finish line, guys. It's one of those things where Adirondack could be torrified. I know a lot of players like Spoon Phillips and Aaron Short
My key
who
grip.
really, you know, have different opinions on
Taking
should
a
you
break.
torrify Adirondack or not. But yeah, it's one of those things. You certainly should. You should try both if you have the opportunity. But if you have the opportunity,
Uh-huh.
please consider sharing this program after it's over. We're just about going to wrap things up. I want to sincerely say this has been a lot of fun. I want to thank David. I want to thank Isaac, all you guys for watching. If there's something we didn't get to play on today's program and you really, really do want to see it, please message me. You can email me support@mauriesmusic.com. A lot of these great Blueridge guitars are in stock now, and if there's a video you want to see that we didn't get to play, for as much as I wanted to play these guitars more than we got to, I'm really lucky to have had Isaac and David join me today. I want to thank those guys. And if we play our cards right, we can do this again sometime, whether it's a whole show dedicated to questions or maybe just, you know, feature one specific Blueridge and bring these guys back on the camera. I'm not sure if David can still hear me, but I want to say thank you, Isaac, for being here. And David, give us a nod if you can hear what I'm saying.
Yeah, it's a little bit distant. I think my earbud went out, but yes, I can hear you, and I apologize for that. We were batting 1,000.
Not at all. It was the only thing I said that wasn't interesting, so you picked a good time for your cameras.
No. Everything you say. And by the way, we'd be honored to come. We'd be honored to come back anytime. I mean, this is as fun as it gets. This is why we do this. That's the whole
Absolutely.
Point, besides playing, right?
Well, that's the problem. I mean, you guys took a lot of songs away from me today, but I'm gonna make sure you make it up to me in some other way. And normally I'll play guitar the whole time, and that's got its own thing too. So thank you to everybody in the chat. Thank you, David and Isaac, and everybody from Saga Music. If there's something we didn't get to, let us know in the chat, in the comments section after this video is over. If you could think of something that would have made this video even better, we'll do it next time. So thank you, everybody in the chat, Jim, David, Andy, old metal dudes here. All you guys for being here. The chat's where it's at. If you guys weren't watching this program, would have no reason to be here. I want to thank you again, Saga. This is Maury's Music signing off, virtual tour. And you guys come back at us next week, and we'll be back to normal as it can get. But thank you, David. Thank you very much, Isaac. Have a great evening.
Thank you.
Happy holidays.